PixMix is brought to you by The Arrow Meta Show, broadcasting on Liberated Syndication on youtube.com/Arrow Meta Show and is in association with the Old School Lane podcast.
PixMix is brought to you by oldschoollane.blogspot.com and is associated with The Arrow Meta Show.
Welcome to PixMix with Aaron.
And Patricia.
Hey Patricia, how you doing?
I'm doing much better now that we don't have to worry about anything like Cars 2 anymore.
Yeah, but now I feel like we've hit the wall. And it feels a bit like, I just made it sound like an E. So,
yeah. Yes. So, yes, let's finally get rid of our earthly thoughts and go up in space.
This film for me is quite extraordinary, actually, because this was the first Pixar film that did not really rely so much on vocal effects, rather than, because, you know, we've had vocal jokes made in Toy Story and in various other cartoons as well, but it wasn't, and Ratatouille kind of tried to drag us away a little bit from that, tried to concentrate more on physical comedy, but Wall-E was the physical comedy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the movie that proved to us that just because a movie doesn't have a lot of talking, it's going to be automatically boring.
Mm-hmm. And so before we get into Wall-E, we have to go on to the attached short. And so there was two. There was the Pixar short film Presto, which was attached to Wall-E, but also there was another short film on the Blu-ray and DVD known as Bernie. So, I've seen both of them, and Presto is basically, it kind of reminds me of a Warner Brothers cartoon. Do you remember when that one with Bugs Bunny, when he has, like, the magician, and obviously he's wrecking all of his acts and everything? And I think Presto, to me, was basically kind of like that. Like, he was trying his best to do all these, magic tricks and everything like that, but the rabbit would be his folly, basically. In doing all of that, so that was my experience with that. And also, if you notice, there was actually a cameo appearance, because in the theater, Slater and Waldorf can be seen in their box.
Yes, that's actually pretty funny. And this must have been around the time in which Disney had purchased the rights to the Muppets.
Mm-hmm. So it was a nice fun one. And on top of that as well, we also I guess we kind of get a little bit of a side story, because in the other short film that was released with it was Bernie, and this was the poor robot who was after the kind of like the one of the scenes in Wall-E. We won't talk about it yet because we'll talk about it in Wall-E, but Bernie basically gets locked outside the spaceship, and he's trying his best to get back in again. So That was pretty much like that. So, nice little short films. Really did appreciate what they did. And, I think they complement the movie pretty well. So Presto gets us excited for Wall-E, and Bernie is a nice little addition to, comedic addition to those. Let me just safely say this. This is probably going to be quite a lengthy episode, because there is a lot of Wall-E to go through. And I think when it was first announced, it was, in a way, it was kind of like a bit of a scary film, because this little cute film is basically talking about, you know, the apocalypse, pretty much. You know, the world has literally ended at this point. And the only thing left is our little robot companion here, Wall-E. So the earth has been barren, wasteland, and covered for literally mountains of trash, suffering from the numerous sandstorms and torrential downpours. Over 700 years, the mega conglomerate corporation, by and large, assumed control of the planet's entire economy, including the government, and spiraled into a state of mass consumerism, quickly covered by the planet in garbage. By the year 2105, BNL CEO Shelby Forthright sponsored a 5-year exodus from Earth into space on board one of the fleets of BNL Starliners, so the most prominent of them being the Axiom, BNL's largest Starliner. 40 miles long and 10 miles wide is a luxury cruise, while Countess Worley, also known as Waste Allocation Load Litter After Earth Class, units were left behind to compress all the trash into small cubes while they used to build colossal towers to be incinerated by a huge city block wide size incinerators, which was proposed as Operation Cleanup. So, you know, at the beginning of the film, they explained it all pretty well. They did it through the narration of Shelby Forthright. So, pretty good, interesting start to the film of just putting us in this kind of derelict wasteland and then just kind of explaining everything that's going around us. Because, you know, and that's one of the great things about it, because the whole atmosphere, the whole world tells a story, even when it's barren.
And again, I think I'm going to reiterate what I said in this Sega Genesis podcast that I had you and Tom in, that the plot of WALL-E is very, very similar to the Sega Genesis game called Vector Man, in which it takes place in the future and humanity has left Earth because it was really polluted, and robots are there to clean up the planet so that someday, if humans want to go back, they can. And you know, the main character, Vector Man, his position is cleaning up the Earth by taking all the toxic sludge and, like, throwing it to the sun. And the difference is that, you know, it does feature another robot, but he gets accidentally struck in the head and he becomes the main bad guy called Warhead. And Vector Man, when he returns back to Earth, he sees that Warhead has pretty much taken over, and he tries to fight him right before, you know, he pretty much destroys everything. So, yeah, I'm actually really, it's just really funny that a very obscure Sega Genesis game would have a very similar title to a beloved Pixar movie.
Yeah, and you know, within WALL-E, to me, it's like I like the whole kind of the whole quiet atmosphere that starts off with it. It's kind of, it's the calm before the storm, and your imagination kind of has to kind of figure out basically what's gone on here. You know, why is this planet so barren? Why is what happened? And what has gone on here? And they leave that to the people kind of witnessing what is going on, the audience, if you will. And while it does explain basically what has happened and why we've got to this point, it still leaves you with this sense of curiosity, which I think is very good to start with. If you're going into the strength I find in films sometimes is the amount of curiosity it generates. If you create a world with loads of curiosity and asking you lots of questions, that can only be good, you know, to start off with, because you're going to keep the attention of the audience. And so WALL-E does that spectacularly well in the first act.
So. Yeah, it does. And a lot of people were kind of skeptical about if this was going to be, like, really boring for kids. Would kids be interested in watching something that has little to no talking? Would their attention spans shorten up and grow bored? Would they want to see talking happening? But no, for a lot of people, this was like the best part of the movie. That they absolutely loved this scene in which there's no talking and you get to have your imagination tell the story as what's going on. So
it's because the visuals are talking to you, and so when you have the visuals talking to you, you don't really need talking. You know, and that's one of the great things that WALL-E's demonstrated to us. You know, when you think about it. And so because the world is so different in itself, it wants to kind of tell you what's happened. In a way, it's kind of like imagine if we knew what Mars was like before, obviously, it became like red and barren. and everything like that. Imagine if there was like there was there is evidence to say that there was life on Mars, you know, before obviously you know what whatever happened to it happened. And so you know, it's kind of like, imagine if you were if you knew what Mars was like, you know, maybe like millions or probably even billions of years ago or whatever, and but then you are then confronted with this this barren red planet with barely anything on it. And so then, you know, your imagination, your mind starts to want to ask questions about what happened. You know, this is massively different to what I was confronted with before in my life, and now here we are, you know, with a very different situation. I want to know more. And so that's what Wall-E Peer does very well. So
yes. Yeah, it builds up the mystery really well about what happened to humanity. How did humanity pollute this entire world to the point in which they can't live there anymore? And, you know, what happened to the rest of the robots cleaning up? Because we saw in the beginning of the movie that they did get a whole group of robots, and their job was to compress the garbage and basically have it more habitable for humans to live in. But unfortunately, you know, Wall-E is the only one left after 700 years of the robots pretty much being reduced to being decommissioned, and the whole 5-year travel, and, you know, now they're being up there in space for 700 years. And I think even MadPad did a really interesting film theory about if they're up there for 700 years, where are they getting their food supplies? Because if they were supposed to be there up there for 5 years, how are they getting, you know, food for up to 700? And it actually goes into a really dark direction, which I'm sure a lot of people already know about it. But if you don't know what Matt's answer to that was, I'm not going to spoil it.
Okay.
But the point is, yeah, it actually brings up a lot of questions, and you want answers, and it lets your imaginations and your thoughts kind of like put the pieces together of how you perceive it. And everybody has their own different opinions.
Mm-hmm. So obviously we were introduced to this world, and then obviously we were introduced, but mind you, after then you realize you have Wall-E. Which brings you even more fascination, because this, the way that the Wall-E robots were introduced is that they're basically just mindless drones from the looks of it. And but, you know, Wall-E is different. He obviously can, like, seem to have thought for himself. And it'd be interesting to see how he came to that. I mean, was it ever explained how Wall-E came to kind of be who he is?
Basically, from what we've been seeing, like, very subtly, like, he would just do his job, and then he would go back into his little trailer where he would, like, charge up his batteries, or he would just sit around and watch Hello Dolly, and he has a little cockroach friend, and he just builds up a bit of a sensitive side towards him.
I know, it's like, but it's interesting to see how that developed. Like, you know, was that a flaw in his programming? Was it was there some kind of idea of that this was to be like have some kind of AI in them? Like, so they can, like, maybe learn about what they're doing? Or, you know, I think, was it some kind of, like, design flaw that, you know, did all Wall-Es eventually, you know, become this type of thing? And, I don't know, maybe it was, like, was there, like, you see, like, smashed up ones, like, lying around the place. Like, it'd be pretty dark if it was, like, you know, these Wall-E robots kind of, like, you know, had, like some kind of war, like, within the 700 years they've been, like, in there. And, like, you know, Wall-E's, like, the survivor of, like, you know, like, some kind of, like, you know, massive robot conflict on this planet or something like that.
Or it could be a possibility that maybe they have cognitive thought about, you know, I've been doing this for so long. It seems like a huge job. It's pretty inevitable that I'm never going to get it done. So maybe they kind of, like, shut themselves down.
Maybe, but somehow Wall-E decided to stick around, which is quite amazing to me. And that as well, like, on top of that, it'd be interesting to, you know, interesting to see how he came to befriend a cockroach and how he decided to collect all these things that he finds fascinating. And because he develops pretty much human characteristics at this point, and even some of his Eve in a minute, but in his own character, he's developed this appreciation and fascination for all these things. And he also mentioned, you know, the VHS tape of Hello Dolly. And which has taught him how to dance and how to his motions. And maybe that's where he got it from, maybe. Maybe that's where he's maybe that's maybe Hello Dolly maybe went into his programming, and maybe that changed him in some way.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. Yeah, it could be a possibility. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, it would be interesting about find about, like, what was Wally's personality like in the beginning when humans were about to leave? Was he just like did he have like no personality? Was he always following orders? Because yeah, we do see a sensitive side to him when he watches Hello Dolly, when he befriends a cockroach, and when he seems to have like a little bit of hope of just continuing to clean up the world, even though that 700 years has passed and it looks like humanity's never coming back. So I do think that he has a bit of hope inside of him, yeah. Especially when we talk about later on in the movie.
I know, and like, you know, and tell you what, we're not even out of the first 10 minutes when you think about it, because I mean, on top of that as well, the way they've introduced us to Wally, and they have us sympathize with him at the end, and we've barely got into it yet. Like, you know, it's I would say, would I dare compare it to I mean, the first 12 minutes of it of Up, where
yeah, you know, pretty much. I think that a lot of people over the years has compared the first half of Wall-E to the first 10 minutes of Up, in which there's no dialogue, there's like atmospheric music, you get to see like a montage of everything that the characters are going through, and it's the best part of the movie because we get to sympathize with them and we get to see their lives, and that's pretty much all we need.
I know. So so now we've got this sympathetic character Wall-E. He's all alone on this, you know, this rock, pretty much, off we would call planet Earth, surrounded by garbage, even floating around in space. And Wall-E goes out again, and basically does his normal routine, only this time he discovers a red dot, you know, and he follows that red dot, and then it goes to another collection of red dots, and then a rocket almost pretty much lands on his head at this point. And he's there hiding because he didn't realize, you know, he's absolutely terrified of, because he's never seen this before, and obviously it's a new phenomenon to him. And, you know, and again, it plays towards Wall-E's characteristic of, you know, being somewhat human. Like, you know, if you had something like that, you've never seen it before, and it would be, it's like, it's pretty much an alien landing, pretty much. It's like, you know, of course you'd be terrified of that. You know, like, you know, something, yes, comes from another planet, and like you've never seen it before, and you know, so that's another way you can you know, that makes Wall-E relatable, because you probably would do the same thing in the same situation, probably.
Absolutely.
So then at this point we're introduced to Eve, and I love Eve in this film. I think she is, you know, is like, she's like driven by obviously her mission and her objectives, but at the same time she's sort of like also aware as well. So I guess you could say she's pretty much, I guess you could say, you know, Wall-E with attitude in a way. Like,
yeah. I guess if Wall-E never humanized himself by watching movies and by befriending the cockroach, then maybe Wall-E could have been that. Just focus on his mission. Except that Eve is a modern robot, in which she has the lasers and she has skin eyes, basically looking around for life. But yeah, Wall-E's a much more older model robot. I mean, he's over 700 years old. So he is much more limited compared to Eve. I mean, Wall-E can't fly, and he can't scan, and he can't talk, except like bits and pieces. Like, I mean, compared to Eve, in which she does have cognitive sense, but basically Eve is much more advanced than Wall-E. But at the same time, you kind of wonder if Wall-E didn't you know, humanize himself, and he would have been like very robotic, would he be similar to Eve, in which he's just focused on the mission and nothing else? So we have Eve, and she's blowing up everything, and her main mission is to find life on Earth to see if it's habitable.
Yeah, and so she's obviously she goes around pretty much blowing up the place. There's like a montage of you know, Wall-E trying to get her attention. I mean, this is the thing as well. Like, we're also kind of like, I don't know what, I don't know if we assume Eve is obviously female, I guess, and I assume we make the assumption that Wall-E, exactly, is male, yeah, but they are robots. But I mean, obviously we get the whole montage of, and obviously you got Wall-E because he's been brought up on, you know, the that VHS tape. Obviously he's got some kind of like, you know, a romanticized view of what's going on. So he ends up kind of, guess, falling for her And then obviously,
Exactly. He falls for it really quickly.
yeah, and then he's like, then he's obviously like building shrines towards her and stuff like that. He's like, oh, gee, you've not seen that before, but and hey, just borrowing from good material, that's all I can say. But so they obviously, he makes that shrine out of, like, you know, a toilet. A toilet seat and everything like that, and leave doesn't know what to make of it and just kind of walks away. And obviously Wally's dejected because of what's going on. But then obviously Eve is obviously frustrated and blowing the whole thing up, and then just kind of like amazingly just kind of just calms, you know, then just kind of feels defeated because obviously she can't find what she's looking for, which is obviously some kind of organic life on the planet. And then we get to the point where Wally goes up next to her and convinces her, Eve, to go back to his pad, which is like
Yeah, and basically, when she's looking around the pad, she sees like this old stuff. Like there's a Rubik's Cube, there's rubber duckies. Then he shows her the TV with Hello Dolly, and they have the song number. And Eve is like really just shocked by Wally because he has a human side that she's never seen before because she's all robotic, and she doesn't know what to make of him at first, but then she kind of sees his charm, and it does develop into this really strong relationship later on.
Yeah, I love all the little things in it as well, like Eve trying to pronounce her name, and obviously Wally can't do it, so she's like, Eve, and Wally's like, Eva. Just this that's adorable. And all the gags as well, like all the props. And this is what I really love about the physical humor, like all the stuff that's in there. So Wally will give her a light bulb, and the light bulb will light up because obviously she's got, like, electric going through her fingers and stuff. And then he'll give her the Rubik cube, and she'll solve the Rubik cube like in the space of a second. And Wally will just be like amazed at how she can do that. And obviously, it shows the Hello Dolly, and then kind of Eve also kind of relates to the film as well alongside Wally, and then eventually he show, but then obviously it all starts to go downhill when Wally introduces her to the plant, and then she realizes that's her objective, and then she locks up. So.
Yeah. So basically, the moment that he shows her the plant, she basically just steals the plant and stores it in herself because that was her main mission all along. And then she basically goes into standby mode. She basically just like stops. She doesn't move at all. And Wally's confused. He's like trying to activate her again because he thinks that, oh, maybe she's dead. But no, in reality, she's just actually creating a homing signal so that the ship can pick her up and then take her back over towards the Starliner where she's originally from so that she can give the plant over towards the captain.
Yeah, I was thinking
And
because
then
was
Wally gets dragged along to this.
yeah. So the whole, like, you can tell that Wally, like, you feel really bad for him because, like, it's his only, like, companion, like, in the on the entire planet, like, and that he's probably had in like 700 years, and now obviously she's kind of gone, and you can see he's like going through the motions of like unwilling to let go. So he's like taking her out like on dates and things like him, but she's just kind of non-responsive, and then he's like doing all this stuff to try and get the plants out and things like that to try and get her reactivated and stuff. So, and then obviously the ship comes back and tries to and gets Eve and tries to launch off, but not without her taking Wally with him. And then we kind of get to the I mean, this is the point where people actually start to get disappointed with the film because a lot of people don't really like the scenes on the Axiom, from what I've been
Yeah, they
told.
really don't. They say that it just pretty much goes downhill from here, that the message is just shoved down your throat and the environment is just not as fascinating. And oh, it's just basically hammering into the fact that oh, this is what people humanity is going to be like in the future and what have you. So
I don't like, well, the first thing I'll definitely say about it is, like, the space scene is a bit is like, it's not the most fun montage, if you ask me. Like, I could think, you know, the montages with Eve, you know, with Wally and Eve are a bit more in the first instance, are a bit more funny. The montage with, you know, Wally giving Eve all the props was funny in itself. I think the problem problem is that because we've had so much fun, I think, in the first act, I think the it doesn't really have much to kind of, like, proceed on, I think, after that. So, you know, the whole fascination of, like, Wally being in space and everything like that, it doesn't really go as strongly as the other ones were, because the other ones kind of, like, grabbed you because they were physical comedy, and then the other ones are just kind of like eye candy, if anything, like, you know, oh, Wally's flying around in space, oh, he's touching stars, he's doing all this other stuff and things, like, you know, it just doesn't feel that, you don't feel like you're in, like, the mood for it, really, when you've been always introduced kind of like what Wally kind of mainly is, when you think about it. So when we finally get to the Axiom, and the one thing I'll definitely say when we get to the Axiom, I don't like how we've transitioned from realistic human beings to, like, you know, Play-Doh, pretty much. Like,
yeah, they have the same body structure as Baymax from Big Hero 6.
I know, but, like, here's the thing, though. If you're going to use those types of human beings, why use a real person in the beginning? I don't get that. Like,
I was just about to say that, because in the beginning of the movie, the main actor that we first see, other than just humanity and then later on Wally, is a live action actor. We have Fred Willard coming in and doing the announcement about that people are going to be leaving Earth and going around for 5 years. It's a real human. And so when we see a real human, which has never been done in any Pixar movie up to this point, and I don't think it ever happens again, so we see a real human and then transition over to these Baymax looking humans.
I know.
And it just looks so weird.
Yeah, it's just like, and after we've come off Ratatouille as well, because Ratatouille came out before Up. And, you know, and also on top of that, there was The Incredibles before that. Like, don't tell me you couldn't do, like, human beings, like, you know,
I mean, I guess because both Ratatouille and The Incredibles were done by Brad Bird, I guess Wally was the first attempt of them doing humans that doesn't involve with Brad Bird, and I guess they didn't exactly do it very well. They couldn't exactly capture what humans would actually look like. I guess they would perfect it later on in Up, because they actually do look like humans.
I personally don't like it because it creates a continuity error in my fan fiction. So, because I decided to do, like, a what if sequel to Ratatouille as one of my fan fiction, and one of my characters drinks BNL beer. So, just kind of tie the movies together. But now that we know that, so there were somewhat real life human beings, I think, around about the time of that time, it doesn't just doesn't add up, really. But mind you, isn't there other BNL, like, cameos in other Pixar films? I'm just trying to think, because I'm sure there are.
And Up. I think, is the one that has the cameo in Pixar, because I think there was a Pixar theory about that the construction company that is, like, leveling down Carl and Ellie's neighborhood are BNL.
Okay.
So, yeah, I think that BNL has featured at least on Wally. As for the other movies, I haven't seen any cameos of it yet, but at this point it could be, and we just missed it.
So we're going back to the Axiom, and this is obviously where Wally is introduced to this, like, crazy world of, like, where robots basically do absolutely everything for the humans. Humans barely interact with one another. They're always, like, on their
speaking of which, do you know who is the female voice of the computer? It's Sigourney Weaver. So she did this, and then she would do Finding Dory. So I guess Pixar just loves her for announcements of things.
And so it's a world basically like a resort, but everyone's kind of like, imagine, you know, going on holiday, but you're spending in front of your time, your face, like, 2 inches across to a tablet, pretty much, and you don't, like, appreciate anything that's around you, and it's pretty much the laziest ship in the world, pretty much. I would say probably I'd probably say the ship on Red Dwarf was probably more active than than the ship on the Axiom. But
yeah, pretty much, because all they ever do is just lay down and eat and do absolutely nothing.
Yeah, and it's even to the point where the captain will basically turn the day back to basically do the morning announcements. So it's like, you know, oh, everyone's like lunching at the moment. Okay, well, we're turning it back to the morning anyway. And I'm going to do the morning announcements. It's the only thing I ever get to do on this ship. So So they go through this whole thing, and then I mean, I've got to be honest with you though, a lot of what is here isn't, even though it is somewhat funny, it still isn't that interesting when you think about it. It just
I mean we already have like the robot who's basically like HAL 9000 who's basically like telling the captain we must you know, we must go into this course. We must follow the mission and what have you. So it's basically like he's the one who's running the place because the captain pretty much does nothing. He just sits around and look important. He's basically a figurehead. All he does is like he commands everything, but it's the robot who's the one in charge.
Yeah.
And
well,
we've already seen that before.
The robots are pretty much in charge of the ship. They do everything that they do. It's like the humans at this point are just, you know, just basically mounds of flesh. They don't really like really do anything. They even, you know, like the robots play the tennis, the robots like you do all the relaxing, the robots, you know, do the parasails, the robots just do everything at this point.
Yeah,
so they're in total control. Yeah. So, we get to the point where, I mean, the only interesting point we actually ever get to in all of this, you know, they do, like, loads of jokes about, like, the ship and everything, but the only joke, really, that we get to is, not the joke, the only kind of, like, when the story moves forward is basically when we get to the captain and we get to the robot that basically drives the ship. And we find that they finally open up Eve and they find that the plant is actually no longer there. And then, obviously, then when they're trying to get rid of the plant off the ship, Wally rescues it, and obviously he gets blasted into space for his troubles. And so then they go back to the captain to tell him about the plant again. But then I keep forgetting the name of the robot that's there, the HAL robot.
Otto.
Is it Otto?
Otto.
It is Otto.
Yeah, his name's Otto.
So Otto. Then finally reveals that the mission was never to allow the humans to go back to Earth, but basically just to keep them flying around on the Axiom because it was easier. So
easier, right? Mm-hmm. And if there's one thing that I really do appreciate with that particular scene is when the captain, when he finds out about it, so that you know, the robot's job is to help the humans survive, and then the captain says, "I don't want to survive. I want to live." That really hits you right there and showcasing that, you know, humanity does have a little bit of hope, that we're not just absolutely hopeless and letting robots take over everything.
Yeah. So the captain starts to start taking control again and tells him to arrest all the droids that are basically helping out Otto. But Otto locks up the captain and shuts down Wally and then it drops both for Wally and Eve into the trash and starts to assume control again of the ship. So and then we get then obviously Wally is dying because obviously he doesn't have his chips to replace him with, and the only way they can do that is basically getting back to Earth. So
and the only way to get back to Earth is if they get the plant and they put in the coordinates so they can be able to go back down to Earth. And I want to bring up another video again. I'm sorry for doing this, but I want to state that the Nostalgia Chick did a video on the Lorax and about the scene in which that the kids have the seed and they have to plant it right before the guy who runs the town gets rid of it because they want to have process air. They don't want to have trees so that, you know, we can get air for free. And then she brings up an interesting point about, like, what's the point if, you know, they did lose the seed? Nothing, they wouldn't lose anything because it's pretty much unnecessary to the plot. And then she brings up the fact about Wally. Like, why do we need to bring Wally back to Earth? Because he was destroyed and he's dying. And putting the plant back into the ship so it can go back into Earth is what our main conflict is. It's important. And so now we have this huge struggle that we didn't have before in which, oh, here's our main conflict. Wally is going to die. And if we don't do anything soon, then he's going to be decommissioned and he's not going to return again. And Eve, you know, this is when she starts feeling the love for Wally that she didn't have before in the beginning of the movie when all she cared about was the mission. So she puts the plant into the contraption and it sets the coordinates all the way to Earth, and then everybody is just like, moving back and forth, like a huge gag going on about like they can't use their legs so they can walk away. They're just being sliding all over the place. And then finally they land on Earth, and then Eve puts Wally back together.
And I get, I tell you what, the final act, I think, I'll definitely say, really does play at your emotions, because I mean, I don't know, there was a part of me that it kind of made me wonder, though, because when they first start up, when Wally starts back up, he basically just reverts back to his default programming. But what triggers, I mean, I guess you could probably compare it to maybe the I mean, I don't think it is comparable to the final scene of Coco, when Miguel plays the Remember Me song to make Coco remember where she is and what's going on. I mean, I don't know if it's the similar thing here where Eve gives a, starts singing that theme to Hello Dolly, and then gives him that spark, and maybe that triggers something. I don't know. Maybe it's something similar to that, but
Possibly.
yeah, possibly. But
I mean, I would, it would be an interesting twist if maybe when she does get the parts to fix Wally, and maybe when he does come back, he is reverted back to his original state. Like, before, he started watching Hello Dolly and befriends the cockroach, and maybe he just is like following the mission of cleaning up the earth, and he doesn't have the love. That would have been interesting if maybe if he was to resort to that. What would that? It reminds me again of like Toy Story 3, in which when what you call it, when they had to push the button to reset Buzz to his original state. And then he just like focuses on the mission, for protecting the Earth from evil Emperor Zurg, and he gets like really angry, and Lotso basically like manipulates him, saying that they're working for Zurg. And then when they try to reboot him again, when they push the button, he goes into like a Spanish version. And I'm actually curious. It's like if they try to revert Wally back after he was crushed and almost dies, would he immediately go back to what he was before?
Yeah, I don't know
Or,
exactly.
I don't know. That's actually really interesting. I'm
I'm
actually
trying to think of
curious
the
about
Pixar
that.
timeline. Are we saying, in the Pixar timeline, did Toy Story happen after Wally, or I'm trying to think, because
I don't know. I mean, it's kind of complicated. I mean, like, I guess because it does take place in the future, and Toy Story does take place like in whatever time period that the movies came out, like you can definitely tell that the first movie did come out in the 90s. So I guess if we were to argue about that, I guess it did kind of like take place before that. But then you have A Bug's Life, which a lot of people think it takes place after Wall-E, because there's no human beings and there's only one tree that is growing where the ants live. And a lot of people are saying, oh, this is the seedling, and it grows into that tree.
Yeah, because I was saying that obviously the toys being intelligent as they are, you think they were robots in themselves, and I thought maybe that technology would probably be like after Wall-E, you would think,
I have no idea,
now
to
maybe
be
they
quite
just
honest. I don't.
maybe the factory's just like, is intelligent itself and just building these toys on it. I don't know.
I mean, maybe it can go like a Legend of Zelda situation in which there's like alternative universes and split timelines, in which like this is the Wall-E timeline where humanity is gone, and this is the Cars timeline in which, after the people of Wall-E go, then it's being populated by cars because maybe humanity has gotten smarter to the point of after creating like the robots, maybe they created cars as well. Or then we have this time, and then we have the good dinosaur timeline in which the meteor never hit Earth, and then we see what dinosaurs would be like in the 21st century. It's complicated.
Yeah, you can definitely tell how interesting the second act is when we're actually spending more time talking about Pixar theories than we actually are talking about the movie.
I mean,
So,
what's there to say? You have the captain and the robot, and you have Wally meeting up with John and Mary, and they kind of become a couple, even though they don't really do anything in the movie. You have these two robots named Bert and MacIntosh, who are like these defective robots that are put off on the side, and they kind of have like their own little fun things, but there's not really much interest to talk about compared to the first act, in which we did talk about like the environment and Wally and then Eve and just everything about it, in which we dissected and we come up with all these interesting theories and discussions.
yeah, it's kind of like it goes off to like a really awesome start, and then it just dies. It's you know the
Yeah, but hey, we can say that it's definitely a much more better executed, couple of minutes than compared to Up, in which like at least the first act was good and then it goes downhill. But with Up, the first 10 minutes is good and then the movie questionably goes downhill.
Yeah. So, I think we also got to the end of it as well, because obviously there's nothing more after that. I mean, obviously even
No, I mean
Wally
we just
spent.
see, yeah, we just see the captain teaching the little kids about planting, and then they're gonna talk about
Well,
like, oh, we're gonna grow
there was
bugs,
the thing
but
before that, which I thought was funny. Like, you have Wally and Eve having their romantic moments, and then then all the robots are kind of like in front of them, and then Emo has to, like, rush them away because it's like, oh, wait a minute, there's a private moment going on together, and it's like, I thought that was pretty funny in itself. It's like, so. Yeah. So obviously then we come to the point where, the captain's trying to teach about growing stuff and things, and then obviously we get the credit montage with the world basically putting itself back together again. So it's and that's and then we get Peter Gabriel's lovely contribution to the film, which I love as well. So yeah. So it picks
I mean,
up.
hey, I mean, with Peter Gabriel, I mean, at least he's more subtly talking about, what's going on, as opposed to like with Phil Collins, in which he just sings exposition. So there's that. So at least
Yeah,
one
there is.
member from Genesis is able to sing a Disney song, and it actually fits into the scene without being too obvious,
Okay, so the budget for Wall-E was $180 million, so it's actually that's 20 million less than your average Pixar film, I guess, that we've been reviewing recently, and it made about $521 million at the box office. So I'd say that's a pretty good success.
Oh yeah, it's a pretty good success. And critics absolutely love this movie. They love dissecting the movie and they love talking about the environmental messages. Like, they loved this movie.
Yeah, and on top of that as well, it wasn't the environmental message wasn't really shoved down the throat of like other things have done. So and so yeah,
Yeah.
it
Later
has
on,
some,
like
and give it
later on.
credit as well, because it actually had some pretty tough competition at the time, because this film came out at the same time as I think it came out at the same time as the Shrek the Third, and I think the Simpsons movie as well. So.
Yeah, it did. And also, I think that there were some other animated movies that were also coming out that gave a run for its money. But yeah, I think Kung Fu Panda was even out at that time, wasn't it?
I think it probably was, yeah. I mean, was that the I'm trying to think. Was that the year that Jack Black said famously that oh, if I ever want to if I ever want to make a load of money, I just do a Kung Fu Panda movie and then bet all the money on Pixar to win the Academy Awards.
Yes, he did say that.
I think that was his famous speech, I think, and whether it was this year or not, I'm not entirely sure, but anyway,
I wouldn't be surprised if it was.
Award-wise, the film received 6 Academy Award nominations, not Academy Awards, just nominations, the most of a Pixar film and any other animated film for that time. It received the Academy Award for Best Animated Feature, which, is par for the course, really, for a Pixar film. And also, you can see the awards page. You can also There's a massive awards page on the Pixar Wikia of all the stuff that it won. So, and there's a, yeah, it's there is, let me just safely say this, there is a lot. That's it, one. And
Oh yeah.
tell you what, if you and this is probably, in regards to the internet, this is probably the highest on it probably could get at the time. It won the Golden Tomato for the best reviewed film and the Golden Tomato for the best animated reviewed film. So
Yeah, and also in the Kids' Choice Awards, it was nominated as well, but it lost to Madagascar 2.
we're not even going to go there. We're not even going to go there, but anyway. So I think the most important thing now is our scores. So here's the thing about this, okay? And I want people to kind of understand where I'm coming from here. This film got off to a wonderful, great start, a very innovative start in regards to its physical comedy, its introduction to the characters, the music, and everything like that. But I mean, the story kind of lets it down when we get to probably like the second, and it only kind of picks up at the very end, at the very final scene. When they finally go back to Earth. So, these bits do let it down and kind of leave a bit of a grand canyon of story in the middle of what it basically is a grand scene. So, unfortunately, I do have to kind of give it a 7, because that's kind of where I'm at really with
So
this
you're
film.
giving the same score as you gave to Up.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to probably do the same thing, which is also a 7.5, which I also gave to Up. But yeah, I mean, the reason why is because it starts off so great, and it just goes to show you that you don't need a story and you don't need talking in order for you to show to people what's going on in your movie. What they had was just fine, and then when going over to Earth, it just basically just shoves down your throat of the moral and the message. The additional characters are just not as interesting. It just becomes bloated after a while. And then, unlike Up, in which the ending just becomes incredibly ridiculous and jarring, it does actually feature some conflict and a lot of suspense about whether Wally was going to survive or not. And for that, I do give it much more credit than as opposed to Up, in which the first 10 minutes was amazing, and then the character and then afterwards the story was okay. Some of the characters didn't exactly work, and then the third act, just because it's like they threw their hands up and it's like, ah, whatever. So I give it more credit than that. I'm sure that I'm saying a very unpopular opinion by saying Wally was at least better than Up, but yeah, I do say that, even though that technically speaking, it's a pretty good movie, but it's not like the best that Pixar has to offer. So yeah, that's all I'm gonna say.
And so we conclude another PixMix. So we are currently got four to go, I think, at the moment. So,
I think about like three to go,
oh,
because
three to go.
we have Monsters, Inc., we have Brave, and Toy Story 3.
Yep. So we don't know what we're gonna get yet. So we're gonna spin the random wheel right after this. But let me just say. So really, I think one thing that we're gonna predictably do is basically the end movie is gonna be the end of PixMix is definitely gonna be The Incredibles 2. And don't expect it right away, but we'll get there to the very end. And then after that, me and Patricia are thinking of doing like an overall, like it's kind of like a not a top 10, but kind of like just kind of rating the Pixar films the way we have in this. And also as well, we might also bring we don't know who it's going to be yet, but we might even bring in like a guest third judge to like it, because you know if you all kind of look at our scores for the Pixar films. You'll notice that I think you'll probably guess where we kind of rank all the films, you know, from like you know the worst to the best. So I think to make it a bit more unpredictable, we're gonna bring in like a third person to kind of like judge the films for themselves as well and give them their
And to be
scores.
fair, even though that we have stated like a lot of tens, you can tell by our opinions and our voice that we do favor like some movies more than others.
Yeah. So until then, from me, Aaron.
And Patricia.
Take care. And bye-bye for now.
See you later.